Much. It's a great pleasure to be here. It's my first time in Korea and I really enjoy. So thank you very much to the organizer, Daniel and Yong Jung, for giving me the opportunity to be here. So I'm going to be talking about a system which combines two things: epidemics. ODE system for epidemics are well known. And networks. Networks are a bit less well known, and I will try to describe the way I will they will enter into the model. So I'm not sure. How am I supposed to? This one, I did it. But towards here? Okay, fine. Thank you very much. So. Networks, it's a word that is very much used these days, I'm going to consider a model of what is called metapopulation network. Metapopulation, it's a population of population. You can think of it as patches of population. So this biological population living in patches will be modeled as a graph, as a network. The patches are the nodes, and they are connected to each other by roads or pathways that are represented by the edges of this network. There will be a picture on the next slide that will make things clearer. So complex network, I'm not going to give a precise definition, but basically what it means is that it's large, it has many nodes and many edges, and it's far from being homogeneous in terms of connectivity. The edges follow a very heterogeneous pattern, distribution pattern, if you wish. So there are many works about that, and mostly there have been many works by statistical physicists who try to describe those complex networks using methods of statistical physics. I put here some names: Vespignani, and others that have studied a lot and actually started all this method. The main point of focus is that the focus is on the degree of the nodes. So the nodes, each node is characterized by its degree, which is an integer, which is just a way to count the number of neighbors. The number of nearest neighbors in the network topology. In other words, it's the number of edges attached to the node. So the topology is encoded in the probability distribution of those degrees. So here it's a probability distribution on the integer, and we assume that it has finite mean value. So here it's a standard assumption. It's positive for any value. The sum is equal to, it sums up to 1. And I also assume that the average, and in the talk there will be many times this symbol with brackets, which is always going to be an average with respect to some probability distribution. Here it's a discrete average, and a bit later it's going to be a continuous, an integral, but it's always described an average on the network. So we assume that this quantity is finite. So this is about the network. About the epidemics, we assume that there is a process taking place on the network, and meaning that each node is actually made of two types of individuals, susceptible and infected, denoted by S and I, and they are subjected to epidemic transmission. So it's the second, the reaction, if you wish, is epidemic transmission, and it occurs only in the nodes. And along the edges, there is diffusion, which is actually only, which is migration. There is migration along the edges. So, So here is a picture taken from some of his work by this physicist that I mentioned before. So you have a network here with nodes and edges connecting them. It's a non-directed network, so I'm just looking at edges without paying attention to directionality. And if you zoom on one of these connections, then what you have is that each node contains two types of individuals, blue and red, two types of particle, which correspond to my infected or susceptible individuals. And they interact inside the nodes and they possibly migrate, diffuse along the edges. The epidemic transmission will be modeled as simply as possible. Namely, it's going to obey the classical SIS model. So it's the simplest compartment model. It can also be viewed as a schematically as a set of reactions. You might think of chemical reaction. That would be the same kind of model. Namely, if S at time t is a density of susceptible and I at time t is a density of infected individuals, then the encounter between S and I might give birth to a new, there might be a new infected individual coming up with at a rate beta. So beta is a transmission rate of the epidemics. And there might be recovery. So an infected individual might become healthy again, susceptible. And this happens at a rate mu, which is called the recovery rate. So of course, in this model, the total population, which is denoted by N, which is S plus I, is a constant. Either you are S or you are I, but so the total population is conserved. And this, corresponding to this scheme, you write this system of differential equation. So for instance, infected or susceptible, they can come from, they decrease whenever there is a reaction measured by the minus beta SI term, and they might increase due to the recovery at a rate mu, which is written in this term mu I. And the opposite for the time evolution of ddi dt is actually minus ds dt, and this guarantees that there is conservation of the total population. In epidemic modeling, there are classically two assumptions made on this parameter beta, on the transmission rate. It can have different names, but basically, let me call it limited versus non-limited transmission. So limited transmission would mean that beta zero being a strictly positive coefficient, that means that beta equals beta zero divided by n, so there is some saturation effect. It is decreasing with the total population size, whereas in non-limited transmission, it is assumed to be constant, not to be decreasing with the population size. And as I said, it's a very simple model. The total population is constant, and therefore the system is actually not a system. It's one equation for I. So one equation for I, and as it's well known, this equation for I can be the logistic equation in some cases. Namely, if you rewrite it, it's an equation with the right hand side, which is just this quadratic function here I times something minus I, up to a constant. And I'm going to be focusing on the equilibria. And on the asymptotic behavior and on the equilibria. So this is just a reminder of very basic results. So people are looking at equilibria. There is always a healthy situation, a disease-free equilibrium corresponding to I star to zero infected individuals, and this imposes that S star be equal to the total population. And the question, so this is always given, but the question is there another one? Is there an endemic equilibrium with a positive level of infected sustained in the system? And the answer is yes, under some condition on the parameter. And this condition on the parameter depends, of course, on the assumption that is made on beta. So let me skip the detail. Let me just say that there will be another equilibrium when this quantity n0 minus mu over beta is strictly positive, of course. But this is written in two different ways depending on the assumption. So you have a threshold condition that can be written in the first case as mu over beta 0 less than 1. And in the second case, when beta equals beta 0, it's n0 larger than this quantity mu over beta 0. So to summarize, just I wrote all the details, but you don't need to look at it. So to summarize, there is a threshold condition on the parameters, which is necessary and sufficient for the existence of an endemic equilibria with E star positive. And this same condition yields instability of the disease-free equilibrium and stability of the endemic equilibrium. In other words, as soon as the endemic equilibrium exists, the DFE, the disease-free equilibrium, becomes unstable, and the endemic equilibrium is stable. It is a monostable situation. Just note that under the assumption of what is called non-limited transmission, so when beta is constant, the threshold condition means that the population has to be large enough in order for the system to sustain this endemic equilibrium. So it's a condition on the size of the population to see this phenomenon. So this is all basic result, or this is computed, and when I mean stable, it's non-linearly, globally non-linearly stable. It's asymptotic behavior of any solution starting from a positive initial data. Let me move to the network model. So the model I'm going to talk about, it's a continuous version of a discrete model. Let me start by describing the discrete model. So in it, it's a model that has been proposed. That has been proposed in 2008 and 2009 by an ecologist, physicist, Saldana, for the spread of infectious disease in heterogeneous metapopulations. So as I already mentioned, that reaction occurs in the nodes and diffusion along the edges. So it's a statistical model in the sense that the assumption is that in each node, the density of S is going to depend, to evolve with time, and is going to depend only on K. So this is an assumption on, if you want, it's already average over a set of configuration of network. This is an assumption that is made here, and same for the susceptible. In each node of degree k, they only depend on k at a given time. And diffusion is migration, and I will describe this term. So reaction, it's exactly the SES system as I wrote it in the previous slide. So the pink or red term here, the reaction is just is nothing but the SIS system here, but written for each in each node of degree k. And the migration, the diffusion is this blue term. So let me describe a little bit more this diffusion term. So its diffusion comes from the fact the diffusion is along the edges, and it has two terms. One is a term corresponding to outflow from nodes of degree k, and this is the minus dsk term. And there is an inflow coming from the neighbors, of this node of degree k, which is described as this plus term, plus dk, times a certain sum taken over the neighbors. Let me not enter too much into the details, but just one important point is that it's going to be depending on the distribution of degree of the neighbors. And this depends on some conditional probability, which is denoted here by P of j knowing k, which is a conditional probability that an edge connected to a node of degree k is connected to a node of degree j. So I'm going to focus here on, so it's a complicated expression in general, which is going to depend on j, k, on the neighborhood, etc. We make a very, Saldana in his paper makes a very simplifying and important assumption that it's an uncorrelated network. So uncorrelated network means that this conditional probability is independent of the degree k. So what it means, if you think, maybe it's easier to think of it as in terms of social network. So I have k friends, I have degree k, I have k friends, and the question is the following: is the number of friends of my friend related to the number of friends I have myself? And in an uncorrelated network, the answer is no. It's independent of the number of my friends. And that together with other symmetry property leads to a simple expression for this conditional probability, and this expression doesn't depend on k. Because the expression doesn't depend on k, if you come back to this sum is not going to depend on k, and at the end this simplifies and becomes the following model. So the diffusion is just sk minus k over a normalization constant m, which is the average of the degree over the network, it's a constant, times the average time an average term for s and a similar term for I, where the average is just the expectancy, the mean of sk weighted by the probability p of k. Okay, this model was itself derived from previous work, as I said, that used some statistical mechanics framework. I'm not going to insist about that. Based on this discrete model, Saldana obtains results about equilibria, existence, and stability, linear stability, using some matrix method, computing eigenvalues on this matrix for this system, like say, infinite system of coupled ODE. And he also does a lot of Monte Carlo simulations to see, to capture the dynamics of this model. So what I'm going to be talking about is a continuous approximation of this system. So I make a crude approximation, which is of course false, which is that the degree is assumed to be a continuous variable. I will comment on that in a moment. So let me, instead of k, I'm going to have x, strictly positive, which is playing the role of the degree of the node, and the probability distribution becomes a function. I assume it's a smooth function, non-negative, the sum, the integral is equal to 1 between on the half line, and I also assume that p of 0 is 0, which means that there is no isolated patch. People are all connected with probability 1 to somebody else. The nodes are connected, I should say. And I also assume that the mean value of the degree is some finite, strictly positive quantity, so it's an integral. I also assume that the network is uncorrelated, and there is a technical reason for which I need to assume that if beta is equal to beta 0, which is assumption H2, then P has compact support. 0 x max. But in fact, it's not. Okay. In fact, it's all finite, but it's just large. So this is doesn't matter as far as the modeling is concerned. So just to say, towards the approximation, it's been used in other models by statistical physicists. You can probably think it's formal. The derivation is completely formal, but you can think of it by saying that. For this large network, that might be a scale at which the continuous approximation makes sense. And the first thing is that I would like to show that that it makes the model simpler and more tractable, and we find results that are consistent with those obtained on the discrete model, and we improve them, or we can make them more precise in a way. So here is a model, and I think I'm going to write it on the whiteboard because. So I end up with instead of having dsk dt, I have a partial derivative in time, because functions are going to depend on x and t, both s and I. And I'm going to have two terms. So one is the SIS type dynamics. So let me be right with the, put the right sign. So it's I times u minus beta s. And same. And the opposite term for I, so I minus mu plus beta s. And the diffusion term is s minus x over m times some average of s. Alors, I could probably put, okay, some average, I call it small s of t. I will write it separately, and here, I minus x over m I of t. This is for strictly positive and positive x with some initial data. And the important point is that here is a non-local term. The non-local term is that is the fact that s of t is the average of s at time t, namely the integral of x of xt p of x dx. And same thing for I of t, which is going to be the average of I at the at point t. And here m, for the sake of consistency, is the average of the degree. Let me call. So it's the integral of x p of x dx, which is supposed to be finite. And finally, I'm also going to use often capital N, which is s plus I of xt, and small n. Sorry.
Could you please use black pen?
Ah, I don't have. There is no white. There is no other pen, I'm afraid. There is one. Oh yes, sorry for that. Okay, I'll try to. Yeah, it's unreadable. I see. Okay, I'll try to rewrite at least the equation. You will tell me if it's okay. So here is the model. So it's a time evolution model. There are some initial data, strictly positive. I will write the details in a moment. So here is what I wrote. So basically, I repeated. It's repeated here, just with the reminder that beta is either beta 0 divided by n in the case of limited transmission, or a constant in the case of non-limited transmission. So let me focus on this non-local diffusion, since it is the topic of the morning. It's a very simple case of non-local diffusion, and therefore it's explicit. So how can you get it from this? Well, you see that since the non-linearity cancel out, you can add up the two equations, and you will get a simple equation in the case of equal diffusivity coefficient. It's a usual special case, the case of equal diffusivity. So let me look at this case to explain a bit what is this non-local diffusion. So let me denote N is a total population S plus I. I have written now everything I hope everybody can read. And little n is the average of N. Here I mention with respect to the probability P, because it's going to play a role later. So in the case of equal diffusivity coefficient, you can add up the two equations, and you end up with this this equation for n, dndt equals minus d times n minus x over m n of t. So it's non-local because n of t is the average of n, but it's very simple. Of course, it's much more simple than other type of non-local diffusion with a fractionary Laplacian or things like that. Just note that it is the right sign. Okay, maybe it will be clear a bit later. So it is simple. It has a property that it is conserving the total mass in time. If you integrate, you easily find that n of t has to be constant equal to n of zero, and therefore it's a completely basic 1D equation, and you can solve it, and it gives you an explicit solution which shows you that the solution, that what this diffusion, if you may call it that way, is doing is that it's a relaxation at rate d towards some state which is depending on the initial data through the average on the network of this initial data, which is n of zero, the average value. So maybe it's more clear if I make a change of function, namely if I write n as x times u, which is consistent with the fact that it's zero when x equals zero, then u satisfies a simpler equation where I got rid of the x. Namely, u satisfies this equation, du dt equals minus t, u minus average of u. However, it's an average with respect to a slightly different probability distribution, which I denote by q, which is xp of x over n. Yes. So under this form, it's a simpler. You probably heard talks about non-local diffusion of the form J star U minus U, non-local operators often used in biology. Here, it would be average of U minus U. So it's not a convolution operator; it's a more global quantity. This average. Okay. So in terms of convergence, what you see is that this diffusion, it's easier again to see it on the U. What it does, the limit of U as t goes to infinity is the initial average of the function U at zero with respect to this probability Q. And if you look at what's happening in terms of N, it means that the initial function is distributed along on the network according at each node, according to its degree. You get something which is linear and which is depending on x. I don't know how much time I still have. I didn't completely look at the time. 10 minutes. Okay, so now I'm going to talk a little bit about the analysis of the system. So first, there are some a priori estimates. So it's a system where everything is supposed to be non-negative, and in fact the system conserves the positivity. Namely, if you start with initial data that are smooth and non-negative on R+, assuming that, as I said before, that at zero, they vanish at zero, and you assume that they have finite mean values initially, where little s and little I are the average of the network, then you have a priori estimate on any solution, any smooth solution to the system that tells you that the mean value of the total density is going to be constant, equal to its initial value, so small n, little n of t is equal to n naught, and that it conserves and even it, it, it it conserves positivity, and even it gives strict positivity for any later time at any strictly positive point, whereas at zero it keeps the property to that it vanishes at zero. So this is for the initial data and a priori estimate positivity. About global existence, it's the case of limited transmission that I'm going to consider here. So beta is beta 0 over n. Then there is a global solution for any t. There exists a unique solution is to this system. And the proof, not without surprise, relies on a fixed point procedure. So namely, I'm looking at the system C there, and I'm assuming that I'm taking a given set of functions small s of t and small I of t, and I'm solving the system C hat, the corresponding system C hat with this given right hand side. So it's an ODE system, it has a solution, it has a global solution, positive, and we want to close the system but by looking at the average of this solution. So small s hat is the average of big s hat on the network, and same for I hat, so that a solution will be obtained if we are able to prove that there exists a fixed point. And this is possible in the case of limited transmission by a contraction argument in some weighted it's a C0 of 0t with value in R plus, of 0t with value in R plus, with a suitable exponentially weighted norm gives you the existence. In the case of non-limited transmission, it's probably true as well, but so far we only have a global existence in the case of equal diffusion coefficient, which is easier. In this case, there is a unique solution, so it is easier. We know that it's easier. It's also easier here because in this case, the total sum for the hat system, this quantity remains constant, so that it is sufficient to find a fixed point to the operator I, to find a fixed point for the operator on I only and not on S. Well, you find the fact that it's again due to the fact that in this case of equal diffusion coefficient, you really have an equation and not a system. Okay, in general it's well posed, it has a smooth solution for some small time, and again it's probably global existence should not be a problem in general, but so far it's not proven. Equilibria are the main focus of people who are looking at epidemic problems, so let's look at equilibria here. An equilibrium is going to be a function depending only on x, which is non-negative, and which is, I cancel the right-hand side of the system, which is written over there, which gives us a set of algebraic equations for I star of x and S star S of x star. And you have to close the system assuming that those constants S star and I star, that are the also unknowns, have to be related to big S star and big I star by these property of little s star. It's easier to write than to say, but little s star is the average, the integral between 0 and infinity of big s star of x, p of x, dx, and same as I star. So here, I denote by n not the quantity, the total average population s star plus I star. This n not is going to be the parameter according to which we discuss the existence of equilibria, which means are there equilibria such that the total population, total mean population, is equal to this n naught. So can we solve this system, n naught being given, can we find two functions I star and S star? So the answer is yes, we can always take the system always has a disease-free equilibrium, which corresponds to I star equals zero, and S star is imposed by the algebra here. And the real question is there another one, which is an endemic equilibrium where I star is positive somewhere? This depends on the assumption, again, on this beta, so I have to distinguish both cases. In the case of limited transmission, beta star is beta zero over n star this time, then beside the disease-free equilibrium, there is going to be existence of an endemic equilibrium, EE, if and only under some threshold condition, which is exactly the same as for the SIS system. So in this case, it's a simple computation, it's the same condition, and its uniqueness at a given level, for a given value of the average mean population. So for any strictly positive and not given, there exists a unique endemic equilibrium such that the average of n star of x will equal n zero, and it's explicit and it's reminiscent of the thing I have written for the non-local diffusion equation, namely each node gets an amount of individuals susceptible or infected which is proportional to its degree with some normalization. And the values that you get are the same as for the SIS system, except that the total population has to be replaced by the average mean population. So there is no, this is an explicit computation. So the more interesting part is about stability and asymptotic behavior. Linear stability, we find exactly the same condition as the SIS system. Maybe I will skip that because we're a bit late. So it's exactly similar. There is a threshold condition, which is whenever endemic equilibrium exists, then the other one is automatically unstable, and this one is stable, and here it's linearly stable. This can be easily computed. It's based on a solution of linear equations with non-local diffusion. So it's a bit in the spirit of the computation I showed when you have only non-local diffusion. Now, about non-linear stability, we can prove the following result. Non-linear stability, in fact, it's about asymptotic behavior. We can show that whenever they exist, those equilibria are stable, namely, if mu over beta zero is larger than one, then the solution will converge to the disease-free equilibrium that I rewrote here. Let me skip the details here to focus on the more interesting case where mu of beta zero is less than one, when there is an endemic equilibrium and there is convergence to this endemic equilibrium under some technical assumptions. So namely, I will converge to I star x over m and s to s star x over m with the right, which are the values that I showed before. Let me move to this slide where I want to show that this actually leads us to consider a non-local Fisher equation, which is in the following way. Let me skip the first line. I write the equation for I. It looks a bit complicated, but I will simplify it by making the same of function, a change of function, again in the spirit of the one I did for the non-local diffusion equation. Namely, I will factor out the x, and with the proper scaling, I will end up with a function u. And this function u is going to satisfy this non-local, non-linear equation. So here you recognize the non-local diffusion that we had before. And you have a non-linearity, which is a Fisher type non-linearity, because it's u1 minus u up to a constant beta 0 minus mu, which in this case is supposed to be strictly positive. So it's really a Fisher type non-local equation. I of t, I have to make it precise, it's again this average, and it can also be, it's the average of the initial function I, and after a change of probability, it's also the average of u. So really you should think of that as u minus average of u. So it's a Fisher equation on the half line with this kind of non-local diffusion. And what we want to show, this conversion to endemic equilibrium, is actually equivalent to showing that u converges to 1 as t converge to infinity, and this relies on the following remark. This is a nice equation. Let's phi of u is here u1 minus u. It could actually be any nonlinearity with phi of 0 equals 0. And we would have the same result, namely that it is conserves positivity, and strictly, if you start with an initial data which is non-negative with strictly positive average, then the solution is going to be strictly positive at any point at later times. And for the, it's equivalently, you have a comparison principle. The operator associated to this equation satisfies, implies a strong, induces a strongly order-preserving flow in the suitable space of function. They have to be integrable with respect to this probability. Once you have this comparison principle, it helps you to find, to prove that you converge in one. And to do that, you need to construct sub and super solution. And this can be done basically in two steps by saying that you are strictly positive. And once you are strictly positive, the stability of one, monostability, does the job, I would say. So I think I will go very fast on the other case. In the case of non-limited transmission, just to mention that the existence of an endemic equilibria is a bit more tricky in this case. The computations are not so explicit. But we were able to find a threshold in terms of population, such that if and only if the n node, the total average population, is greater than this threshold n bar, there exists a unique endemic equilibrium. And here I wanted to mention that this improves the result obtained in the discrete case. That's the first thing, because the threshold in the discrete model was not optimal. It was only a sufficient condition. And I also want to mention the fact that it's related to some question about complex network, which is to say that if you're looking at the SIS system, there is a threshold. The population has to be large enough to sustain epidemics. However, here you see that the number that we find is reads like that, so it involves 1 over the maximum degree X max. So for large networks with some nodes that have a very large degree, this threshold is going to vanish. It's going to be very, very small. And this is related to a question that is a lot studied. Is there a threshold or not to see this epidemic spreading in complex networks? So it has interesting applications. It's a computation otherwise of equation. Linear stable, I skip that. And I move to my conclusion by saying that we made this blunt approximation, but it seems that when going from the discrete model to the continuous approximation, even if it's formal, nothing seems to be lost. We can recover all the results that have been obtained on the discrete model. We get more precise results, for instance, optimal threshold values for existence and linear stability of endemic equilibria. Of course, existent proof, they are not even mentioned on this discrete model, but we obtained them as well here. And nonlinear stability or asymptotic behavior can be proven rigorously. And I believe mathematical structure is more easily amenable to analysis. That's probably also a matter of taste. You deal with equation instead of dealing with very large matrices. But it yields new properties in the continuous case, that in turn can help to understand the discrete case, because actually the same properties hold for the discrete case. It's just more difficult to see them for the discrete model. And finally, this is a first step, a very simple model, which hopefully will have extensions. For instance, we could look at more general epidemic transmission models. We could consider correlated networks, in which case the non-local diffusion would be much more complicated, and maybe also evolving network or P would depend on T as well. Infinite number of questions. Thank you very much.